room today. How many are thankful that the peace of the Holy Ghost passes all understanding? How many are thankful today that there's nothing that can describe the peace that we have in His presence? All of your care, all of your trouble, all of your hurt, all of your heartache, it's all His this morning. Let's lift our voice all across this building and thank Him for it. There are some needs that we're going to take to Him, but right now we just want to thank Him that His presence is here. We just want to thank Him that His anointing is here. We just want to thank Him that His power is here. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Let me reach over and pray with somebody right now. Reach over and connect with somebody. I thank you right now, God, that I'm able to experience this with my brother. I'm thankful I'm able to experience this with my sister. I'm thankful that I'm able to experience this, God, through anything that I am facing and anything that I'm going through in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Bless your name, Lord. I bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Your presence is heaven, Lord Jesus. Your presence is heaven, Lord Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Araba reshoto roki reboko resheta rebaka reshata reborobo roki tarabashataya. We reverence your authority and your lordship in this house today. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. How many believe that the Lord has power and dominion over everything that's in this house today? Over everything that would try to cause an obstruction, over anything that would try to cause distance, the Lord is in control. The Lord is in control. Amen. And we thank Him today for His presence. Amen. Turn to somebody. Let them know you're glad that they are here today. Thank you for making the decision to come to the house of the Lord today on this beautiful fall morning. Amen. The Lord is with us. Amen. The Lord is for us. And if God is for us, who in this world can be against us? Who in this world can be against us? Amen, amen, amen. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. We want to pray for Sister Kirk. She is sick in body. We need to pray for her today that the Lord would touch her. Sister Romans sent me a message. There is when they were in the hospital with her mom, a young lady by the name of Kellyanne. She's having a baby on the 14th, and there are some complications. And then her mom is, her name is Ann as well. So we believe the Lord can touch them this morning. Believe that the Lord can take care of that this morning. I don't know if y'all saw, but Wednesday night I came up for prayer. I don't know if I'd pinched a nerve or something in the lower part of my back and went to the chiropractor on Tuesday. He tried to loosen it up, and it was hurting. I told my wife Wednesday night on the way to church, I said, I just need a touch. And so I came up for prayer, and they anointed me with oil and prayed with me, just like it says in the book of James, and the Lord healed my back. I have not had any pain since whatsoever. Amen. And so I'm here as a testimony that it works. Does anybody else have a testimony that when you've needed God to touch your body, He's touched your body? Amen, 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 amen. Sister Smith, it's so good to see you here today. We love you. So glad to see her here. And Brother Conkle, it's so good to see Brother Conkle here today. Amen. And we are praying. We are praying for Sister Conkle as well. Amen. And I want us to remember as well here in the 11:30 service, Jerry Lee's supposed to be here today, and she's supposed to be bringing Ryder's dad with her. He is down at Jefferson House right now. She's going to get a pass to bring him up here. He needs a touch from the Lord. And how many believe that this is a hospital? We believe that. That's what we pray for. Amen. This is not a nursing home. This is not a rest home. This is not a comfort zone. This is a place where sick people can come and be made better. Amen. That's the whole reason that we're here. And so we're going to pray for these before the kids come up here today. I want us to lift our voice, and I want us to pray right now that the Lord is going to take care of every situation. And if you have a need, would you signify that by the lifting of your hand? Amen. If you've got a need, you need the Lord to take care of. Amen. We're going to pray right now. Lift your voice. Father, we thank you for the power and the authority that is in your name. At the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow. At the name of Jesus, every tongue is going to confess. And God, we pray for these circumstances and these situations today. We lift up Sister Kirk to you, God, asking you to go to where she is at, asking for you to touch her. In the name of Jesus, we pray right now. God, lift her up above that circumstance, that situation. Lord Jesus, we pray for Kellyanne, that the Romans were able to intersect, Lord Jesus, when they were down in Louisville. We pray for Anne, the grandmother as well. We pray for no complications. Although there are complications now, you're able to take care of those complications. And we speak the name of Jesus over that situation. God, we ask you to move and to touch upon Sister Conkle right now, Lord. You know what your plan and you know what your purpose is. We ask you to move, God, in her mind, move in her body, move in her heart. Lord Jesus, we pray, God, you know what exactly needs to take place and exactly needs to happen. God, we pray for those that are on their way here in the second service today. God, that this place, we pray for the IBC kids that are on the way here. Give them safe travels. Let an anointing rest upon Brother Sargent and Brother Kilman today as they preach the word of the Lord. Let there be a sensitivity and an awareness, God, for every need that is here. Because we know you are the healer of every hurt. We know, Lord Jesus, that you are the waymaker. We know that you are the promise keeper. We know, Lord Jesus, that you are the problem solver. We thank you for that, and we worship you. And every hand that went up, signifying a need that's in this place today, God, we ask you to have your perfect will in every circumstance, in every situation. We bless you for it, and we thank you right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We worship you for it, God. We give you praise for it right now, Lord Jesus. We magnify you, Lord, because of who you are and because of what it is that you have done. Let's magnify and worship the Lord all across this building right now. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. In your name, Lord, in your name, Lord, in your name, Lord. Turn to somebody close to you. Tell them it's done. Tell them it's done. Amen. Want all these beautiful kids, why don't y'all make your way up here on the platform? We're going to do I Am a Christian today. Y'all ready to do some worshiping? Y'all ready to do some worshiping? And we're glad to have Jenna Bell and Honor back with us today. Give them a great big hand. Serenity's back. And then all these beautiful kids with Sister Nikita Breeden. God bless them as well. Take a look at all these kids. Aren't these kids awesome? Let's give them a great big hand. Amen. Go ahead, Brother Sound Man. Let's hit it in Jesus' name.
salvation.
Did we just break a record for the most kids we've ever had up on the platform for an action song? That's awesome! That's awesome! Amen, amen. We're going to dismiss our Sunday school classes. The youth class is going to stay out here. Y'all come up here with me front and center. Let somebody know you love them. Let somebody know you appreciate them. Amen. The Sunday school classes can be dismissed at this time. Amen. Brother Tuttle's coming right now. Greet somebody you haven't had a chance to greet yet. Let them know you love them and you're glad that they're here today in Jesus' name.
Precious Lord, you are wonderful. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. What a group of kids. My, that probably is the biggest number that I've ever seen up there. So we do appreciate the Lord today. Praise God. Aren't you glad that you serve a real God?
Yes, sir.
Not something made up, not something hyped up, built up, or anything else but a real God.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. There's times when you just put something together. I was going to say throw something together. I don't mean that in that context. But there's times that you do. You put something together and, that's Brother Faulkner. He just throwed it together, or I throwed it together, somebody else did. And there is times when you have an inspiration. Now, and I had asked the young people that they would stay in here today, and so y'all can blame me for that, okay? Praise God. But this is one of those times when about a week ago, and you can ask my wife, we were doing a devotion there in the morning, and there was something there. Began to write some stuff down and everything, and so whoever this is, this is for everybody today, okay? This is for me, and no disrespect for our pastor, but this is for our pastor. Is that all right? If you're breathing and you're here today, because of what this is, and I didn't have anything to do with it, the Lord knows, and he knows what we need more than what I do. So you can be seated. Go ahead. I'm sorry. In Jesus' name. And there is a song that I'm going to have them play before we begin this lesson today. And if you have a sheet of paper there with any notes or anything on it, the title of this is One Moment in Time, and we're going to play that song. Want you to listen to it. It is the essence of what this lesson is about today. So if you'd play that, my friend, and we will get right into the lesson.
Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest day is yet unknown. I broke my heart for every gain. Taste the sweet, I face the pain, I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains. I want one moment in time. time for less. I've laid the plans, now lay the chance here in my hands. Give me one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be. When all of my dreams are a heartbeat away and the answers are all up to me. Give me one moment in time when I'm racing with dust and me. Then in that one moment of time, I will feel eternity. You're a winner for a lifetime. If you seize that one moment in time, make it shine. Give me one moment in the time when I'm more than I thought I could be. When all of my dreams are a heartbeat away and the answers are all up to me. Give me one moment in time when I'm racing with destiny. Then in that one moment of time, I will be, I will be free.
Could we stand together today? Praise God, praise God. I realize that's a secular song, but there's some statements in there that if we could take it to heart, then it would be very, very, very beneficial for you and for me. Praise God. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verse 1 through 8, familiar portion of Scripture that you have heard it. You young people have heard it, I'm sure. Says, to everything there is a season and a time and every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. Time to plant, a time to pluck up that which was planted. Time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. There's a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones. Together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. Time to get up and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. Time to rend and a time to sow. Time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. Could we pray before you're seated in Jesus' name? Father, we're asking for your divine will, your divine purpose. God, we ask that every word would have its free course today. God, not my will, but thy will be done in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. You can be seated. Praise God, praise God. I speak blessings over everyone that is here today. Every person that is here, I speak blessings upon you. Praise God. As there is a time and a place for everything, there's also appointed moments in time. And you young people, we'll get into some stuff here. Us talking about moving and all of that, we've been getting into some pictures, and my, it just, oh. Moments of time. And we need to grasp a hold. Hear me. You need to grasp a hold of those moments, because they, in a lot of cases, they either speak of destiny and heaven or disaster and hell. That's just kind of the bottom line, you know. There's really not an in-between there, because it just, you know, those moments are so important. We make decisions and we react, you know. We react to those moments. And, you know, if my reaction is not right, you know what I can do? I can destroy, you know. Let's say that one of you young people is the first time you was ever here, and something was said, something was done. My reaction to that can either make you want to come back to this place, or in your mind say, well, you know, if that's the way they are, then I'm not going there. You know, just a moment. You know, not an extended period of time, but just in one moment. And if we seize that for the good, then, oh, here we can find another one down on an altar and then finding their way to a watery grave and casting all of their cares upon Him. And if I do the wrong thing in that moment, I'm going to really emphasize that today. So you know, you bear with me, if you know, because it is so important. And the thing is, I can't take that back. Never take it back. We can't do that. We leave each day in the moment and in the season of our lives. Just, you know, throughout the day. I mean, there's all of those. You know, at 10:26, a minute from now, that's past. That's past. And if I said, did, or anything at all in that moment, I can never, ever, ever go back and do anything about that, because it's gone. That, you know, the Bible says that we're going to be judged for every, what is it, every dot and every tittle, or just, you know, that's so minute. So why would that moment in time, that little thing, why would that make that much difference? But if I'm going to be judged by, what do you say, every idol? Every idle word? You know, that's pretty broad. I mean, you know, that doesn't leave much out. If every idle word I'm going to be judged by, then I need to weigh what I say. I need to weigh what I think. Praise God. Basically, our lives are just moments in time. And what we do in those moments and how we react and how we make decisions with each of those moments have everlasting impact upon our lives as well as those that are around us. Impact our lives touches each of us. Each moment has an impact both in present and in the eternal. A wise person once said, you know, if we understand the time and the place for each activity of our life, and we find meaning in everything that we do. Now, we can't determine, you know, you had no say in being born. You didn't have any say at all in that. And we don't have, unless I'm just crazy and I go out and do something or commit suicide or do something to where I know that it's going to kill me. Otherwise, I don't have a choice over my death. You know, that's in the hands of somebody greater than I am. Unless I go just do that myself. So we don't have any choice over that. But that span between when I come squalling and crying and bawling and everything, when I was born, from that moment till the day that I lay down my life, there's a span there that I make the decision. Really. You know, and I realize if we put ourselves in the hand of God and we want God's direction, we want His will, His purpose, divine, and everything in our life, if we do that, the choice is still mine. It's still mine. And I can do anything that I want. Anything. You know, somebody said, well, I don't like, you know, I don't want anybody telling me what to do or anything like that. Well, you know, if I'm living for God, I want to make it to heaven. Right. Isn't that what we all want? We all want to make it to heaven, don't we? So, you know, there's certain rules and all scripturally that we have to abide by if I want to make it to heaven. It's not a man-made deal. So all of that time span in between, you know, being born and I die, then I've got a life filled with decisions. As a child or a youth, you know, we can't change really the circumstances of life, and I wish we could for the, you know, some of these kids. And I'm sure probably these little kids that come up here, their circumstances are not the very best in life, you know, and you know, we've taken in a lot of foster kids through the years, and some of those kids that we got, horrible situations, just horrible situations, being put in the hospital because somebody abused them, and broken arms or broken this, and all kinds of stuff like that. So they don't have a choice. But what you can change are the reactions to those circumstances and how that I react to them. Now, you know, it's been a long time since I was in school, 1966, whenever that's been a long time anyway. That's been 50 some years. But you know what they did back then, Brother Faulkner? They were bullies around. They were, you know, smart mouth people that just, you know, thought they were it, and you had the rich people and you had the poor people and everybody in between, and all of that junk went on. And I can remember being kind of shunned a little bit just because we were poor. You know, we didn't you know, and I know today, you know, cleanliness is next to godliness, so you got to make sure you change clothes every day and all that kind of stuff. Well, back then, when you put on a pair of jeans on Monday, you wore them all week to school. That one pair of jeans. That's all. I mean, that's what you did. Because there just wasn't, you know, there was eight of us kids. I'm not throwing a pity party or anything like that. Just, you know, give us just an idea of, you know, the way things can be and how that we react to all of that. You know, back then, I never thought anything at all about that. And you can ask my wife. We didn't. We was kind of the same boat there. And so we thought nothing about that. But then you had those. They saw that you wore that every day. Every day. But, you know, my reaction, thank God I was never in a fight or anything like that in school. Thank God for that. Just kind of mild-mannered, so I let that go. But, you know, they pick on you, and they, you know, they carry on. But your reaction to what they do, to what they say, is going to have an eternal, it could have an eternal impact on that individual. Can have an eternal impact on your life. On all of our lives. You know, we might not think that that's much. Well, I'll just, you know, he said this. Well, you know, I'm going to go back at him and I'm going to smart off to him and I'll stop before I fight. But the thing is, though, that's going to impact you. It's going to impact you. If that's the life that you live, then that's going to go beyond the school. When you get out, then that's going to continue on. But all, if you can turn that around turn that around. Now, I'm kind, you know, I like love stories, just mushy stuff, like, just, you know, you can ask my wife. It's awful. I can sit and bawl with the best of them. It is. It's awful. I embarrass, you know, I embarrass some of my family and stuff like that. But saw something the other day. A story. This child's dad was blind. So you know what they did? At school, there was this one particular kid. He had a stick. And, you know, the dad had one of them canes that you know, and you feel around out here. Well, this kid had a stick. So while this child was sitting in there eating and that kind of stuff, then this kid had that stick and was stumbling around all over the place like this and just making fun because her dad was blind. Story went on, and there was a bully was picking on that kid outside. You know what that girl did? Brother Faulkner, I mean, touch me. Went up to that bully and defended that boy. And when that girl knew something on that big guy. Anyway, he left, and that boy looked at the girl and said, why did you do that? Because said, I wanted you to know how that I feel. What a story. And you know what they ended up? They were like this, the best of friends. Because instead of a horrible reaction, she showed love. What are we supposed to be? Love. We're supposed to show that. And if we can do that, oh, what can God do with us? If we can portray that kind. Now, is that easy to do? Now, you guys, you all know that, you know, because you deal with it every day. Hey, and it's not always the greatest thing if you work at a job, because there's always somebody. There is. There's always somebody. Praise God. Ephesians 5, 15 and 16, it goes like this. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, and redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Our lives can change so quickly in just a moment, in a moment's of time. One moment you're on top of the world and we're just, you know, we think that we've got it all made. And then the next you find yourself right down here on rock bottom. The shooting that just took place here in Maine. Those kids went to that bowling alley that night, not a care in the world. Some of them, you know, moms and dads and the kids and nothing was in their mind about that being it. But in one moment of time, they slipped off into eternity. Oh, why do we need to be ready to meet Him? Oh, God, because, you know, God forbid that could happen. But when we leave here today, we don't have a guarantee that any of us will ever make it home. Not one moment. You know, we don't have that guarantee. And the fact that we don't, then I need to make my calling and election sure according to the Scriptures. I need to do that. It, you know, because I don't have that guarantee that we are going to make it. In James 4 and 14, it says, whereas you know not what you shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It's just a vapor that appeareth for just a little time, and then it's gone, just like smoke. You know, it's gone, just for a moment of time, and we don't know. I've told the story, and this lady, the wife of this fella, has sat in the back of this church before. Was in a church service and before the bill or it ever moved. It was back when Brother Ison was here. We had a family there, and the Lord moved in that service, and the Lord spoke in a message in tongues, and she might remember, I don't know, but in that message said, "This is your last chance. I've basically spoken to you, and I've spoken to you, and I've spoken to you. And if you don't respond tonight, this is it." And I want you to know that man left that church service. And but before he left, though, he went up to Brother Ison and he said, "That was for me." And when he left that night, he was in a car wreck and burned up in the car. That night, not some other time. And I don't know how that you are. God, if you can speak to me, and if I've got a hard head, God, whatever you have to do to make me realize that, God, I've got to hear what you say. I've got to do what you say. Oh. Norma's been redoing some scrapbook things in all here from Ball State. And I mean, brother, it's brought back some times, brought back some memories and stuff. She graduated in 1970, and those pictures, when I saw them, I mean, oh, done something right here. But now that, all that's gone. But oh, that was captured. That picture captured a moment in time for us that can never, I realize that's in the past and I can't relive that or anything like that, but I can look at that picture and think, oh. Now, she told me not to mention this, but I won't say exactly all the stuff. Anyway, she wrote me a letter one time. And in the letter, there was an implication there. And I took it the wrong way, that she didn't need me. And I've never in my life felt anything hit my heart like that. And that, I mean, you talk about a vivid thing that is in my mind, that and I'll never ever forget the feeling that I had that one moment in time. So you know what we need to do? We need to seize those. Grasp a hold of those. I tell you, those times when you can be in the presence of God and those times that you can be around the people of God, you need to seize those. Grasp a hold of those and let God bless you in those times. Praise God. She was reminded of those who, they helped us to remember what life was like during those years when she was in Ball State. She also reminded of those who told her about God, and that's where she ended up, went to Brother Martin's church in Muncie and got the Holy Ghost. Made sure she and those people made sure she got to church. She remembered those times, and those messages. Then there was one time in that service that she sitting there. This is before she had the Holy Ghost or anything. She was coming, and there was a message of tongues went forth, and standing up there. You know how it is. You're gripping the pew. And a message in tongue went forth, and that message basically said, "This is for you." And she, can remember back then. She said, "Hey, look, I'm a good Baptist, and all this. I live a fine life, and everything's great because I'm just I live a good life." And she stood there and just, you know, didn't do anything about that. They had another message in tongues, and she still held off on that. And, you know, each one of these were different wordings, but all pointing and saying the same thing. And finally, there was another one. My God, you know, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for that. That third time, that message went forth and said, this is the last call. Said, if you don't respond to this, then basically I'm done. I'm never going to call you again. And she jumped up out of the pew and ran to the altar. Ran to the altar. One moment in time. If she hadn't done that, then I know, I mean, I wouldn't be here. Jamin would have never been born. Wouldn't be assisting in a church. Beautiful family. All of that because of one moment in time. Oh, how precious, how precious. 1 Timothy 4:12 says, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of believers. Now hear this, in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, and in purity. All of us need to, maybe we need to have a hat that has that written across the front right here, and then all, you know, as the day goes on, then I can just lift my eyes and I can read that, you know, in word, you know, in faith, in charity. Do I need to love that individual? And I could, you know, that would be forever in my mind and in my thoughts, because it would be right there. Praise God. Because every part of that day, every part, so that's so important. My wife was blessed to find God in her youth, wasting precious years without him. Her pictures of her youth reminded her of the good times, the choices she made. How many of you, you know, like to look at, now, especially with you younger people, probably you don't have photographs. I get out my phone, and there's 5,000 photos on there. It might take me 15 minutes to find that one, but they're all on that because, you know, there's no such thing as pictures. You know, we've got boxes and albums and albums and albums and more albums and more albums. They're everywhere with pictures. But, oh, whenever you look at those, when you pull those out, all those pictures, praise God. Just, you know, and we love this man's dad, but right now, you know, if he can pull out a picture, you know, here we are, me and dad, it might be 20 years ago. Now, you can't go back to that, but oh, I'll tell you what, you can find joy in that one moment. Because it was captured. Or it could have been some horrible thing. But a precious moment. And you have the opportunity every day to create those. Every day you have the opportunity to create a moment that can stand in time. Not going back and forth, but it can stand in time because it's there. You've got a picture of that, and we can remember those moments. It's the reason I say you need to grasp those every chance that you get, and let the Lord bless you in that. Psalms 90:2, it says, "So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom." Think about it. I apply our hearts unto wisdom. You know, forget about, you know, hey, and especially you young people. I'm not, you know, I know what it was. I lived for myself, literally. I didn't live for anybody else when I was your all's age. And, you know, it was all about me. Now, I wished I could go back, and especially my mom, who sacrificed and gave so much, wished I could go back and rectify some things there. But, you know, can't do that. But you know what we can do? Especially for you young people, today can be a day and a moment in time that you know, can have an effect on your mom, on you, on your dad, and for those that are around. You know, you can start today, this as a new day, a moment in time that can change somebody's life. We hear news accounts all the time about youth who have made terrible decisions, changed their lives forever, drunk driving, robbery, beatings, someone even committing felonies or taking a drug just once. Somebody talk you into that, and you take that. It's not going to hurt just one time, and you meet eternity because it was laced with something. That's it. Just, you know, anybody like to put some things off? Hey, if it can be put off, you know, and push that back in the corner somewhere, and let's don't worry about that right now. But what if between that moment and when I would get around to do it, the Lord says, it's time. Then what am I going to do? You know, because then it's too late. Right. It's like that thing that I procrastinated about and pushed it back over there. If something happens to me, then that ain't going to make any difference. But there is a hereafter. So that's going to make a difference. Ecclesiastes 11:9-10, it says, "Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart, and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all of these things God will bring thee into judgment." Now this says, young people, this is forever. It's for everybody. It's for everyone. All these things are going to be brought into judgment. "Therefore remove sorrow from thy heart, put away evil from thy flesh, for childhood and youth are vanity." Also, Acts 9:3-6. "And as he journeyed," we know that this story, "came near to Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven." Instead of going ahead and reading that, we know the story of Paul. We know that, or Saul, that how that he was on the road, and the Lord spoke. The Lord spoke. Now, you know, he's responsible for a lot of scripture. Now, what would have happened if he had rejected that? But because of just one moment in time that he adhered to what the Lord had said, and he went ahead and obeyed what God had said, and because of that one moment in time, then we have all these scriptures and literally changed the world because of one moment in time. The Bible's filled with these moments in time that changed lives of men and women. Saul on the road got the greatest shock of his life when that transpired. But he woke up and did that which the Lord wanted. The man he fought against, the people he was trying to kill, were chosen of God, and he realized that he was wrong, but because of that one moment, it changed everything for us down through times. A lot of moments in that are told in God's Word that changed the course of history. Probably the biggest one is Eve eating that. Because up until that point, innocence, free of sin, and just biting into that fruit. That's all it took, because it was disobedience. And it changed the course of the world because of that one thing. What about Noah and the ark? Changed things. David and Goliath talked about. Just because of something that was done, but it was just a moment. You know, none of this stuff, was over years and stuff. It just took place in moments. The birth of Jesus divided how we calculate centuries of time from B.C., which is before Christ, and A.D. is after Christ. And, you know, they're wanting to get away from that now. They don't want to have Christ in that picture anymore. What we do each day can change the lives of others for good or for evil. One moment of careless words or unkindness, of evil intent, of hatefulness from a believer can cause someone unsaved or weak in their faith to lose their desire to find truth. Can cause them to blame the church or to see those who profess truth to be hypocrites. Now, you know, I know someone now that because of the way that the way that his family has been treated by people that say that they're living for God, and his statement is, I'll never be back, because if that's God and that's the church, then I don't want anything at all to do with it. You know, every idle word, it does matter. Anybody ever get aggravated, mad at somebody? I mean, if you're human, then you do that. But what you do in that time, you know, remember that that's gonna come back to you. You know, whatsoever a man soweth, he's gonna what? And if I sow in goodness and love and mercy and all of that, you know what's gonna come back to me? But if I sow in hatred and all of this other stuff, I'm going to reap the whirlwind. And, you know, Brother Farmer, if it was just you, and if no one else was affected, and you wanted to be the horrible individual, well, then go ahead and be that way. But you've got two kids. And you got a wife. But no, you got neighbors. And you know, those neighbors, that they watch you, they listen to you, they hear you, they watch your life, and all of that. Oh, you know. So I need to be accountable. We're all held accountable for how we treat each other. An unbeliever or a backslider, we literally may hold the soul of someone in our hands, and every day, every moment, is monumentous. When it's over, it can never be altered. It can never be lived again. And there are no others in life unless we allow God to correct our mistakes with His mercy. So live each day to its fullest. Enjoy the blessings it offers. Do something that matters in the cause of Christ. And if we would each day just do one good thing, if we would do that, just one good thing, then we could change the world. Do one good thing. I want you guys up there, if you don't mind, to jump over to 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 54, the last scripture there. If you would do that. You read this the other day, brother. It says, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory." All other moments in a believer's life literally lead up to this moment. You draw a line under your life, then this is where it ends up. Every moment of every person's life leads to this time. And, am I living that? Am I living that life? You know, the life that the scripture talks about. Not this life, what this guy wants and desires, but am I living that? Praise God. Remember, just every moment of every day, you hold destiny in your hands. Like that song said, we can either be for the good, we can be for the bad, but oh God, could we stand together? Help us today. Father, move us somehow. I realize adult class and young people and all, but if for you young people, just remember that, there's cause and effect. Cause and effect. And one seemingly small mistake will and very easily be eternally, could be an eternal decision. Just one thing. I challenge you, just, weigh what you say. Weigh what you do. And this right here, this word, that's the roadmap to heaven. Because I'm fallible. And as much as we love our pastor, he can be that too. But that is not. That's forever and ever and ever and ever settled in heaven. And when everything else that's on this earth passes away, says that heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will what? Amen. It's going to stand the test of time, and it never will. So I challenge you, as adults, as young people, live for God, put Him first, and allow Him to be the anchor that holds. And He can, doesn't matter how much tossing to and fro, all of that, none of that matters. because he'll take care of it. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you for being attentive today. I feel like that it was in the will of God. And, got just a few minutes here and come back in. And let's believe the Lord for a move of his spirit. Can we do that? Give the Lord a hand clap in Jesus' name.